Right, so we're up and about early and on our way to our very last location, which is Bamburgh Castle in Northumberland. We're about an hour away now, but we are only 5 hours away from the end of the entire challenge because we're on hour 95 of 100 now.
It feels weird that it's almost finished.
It does. I don't know
what life is going to be like when I'm not on the road with you.
Yeah, it's going to be weird to go back to a desk, that's for sure.
Yeah, definitely.
So unfortunately the weather has totally broken on us, nothing like it was last night. It is absolutely chucking it down with rain, and according to the forecast we've got 48 straight hours of rain now, so really tough conditions.
Fantastic.
To work in.
Love that.
And I think whichever way we cut it, we're going to be shooting in the wet today, unfortunately.
Yeah.
As a British landscape photographer, you've got to be able to deal with these conditions because we get them so much, you know, it's part and parcel of what you do, and you know, you've just got to find ways around it. And I'm sure, you know, Bamburgh is such a good location, I'm sure we'll find a way to get a good shot today.
Yeah, definitely.
So, tide-wise, still feeling fresh, or are you flagging a bit?
Definitely flagging. I think this has been so much fun. I've really enjoyed it, but at the same time, it has been exhausting.
Yeah, one of the downsides to shooting landscapes in the summer is that you've always got very late finishes or early starts. You've always got those sort of unsociable sunrise and sunset times, and it makes... I don't know, it does. If you do it back to back for a few days, it does tire you out. And we've only got 5 hours, and then, you know, 5 o'clock, we've just got to come on, press on for another five, and we're done. So, and then a few hours home. So, we will see you there.
Situated just north of Newcastle upon Tyne and running all the way up to the Scottish border, Northumberland is a seriously photogenic county. The Kielder Forest Park in the west is one of the best astrophotography locations in the UK, owing to its ultra-dark skies, and Hadrian's Wall is incredibly picturesque as it slices through the dramatic landscape of the Northumberland National Park.
So we've arrived at Bamburgh Castle, and actually the weather is so much better than what we were expecting. We've got blue skies, which I don't think either of us were even daring to dream for.
It's absolutely bizarre. The forecast was like, no, it is going to rain all day non-stop. And just by looking out the window, you could see that it was set in for the day, but somehow it's kind of broken up. And yeah, we got a bit of blue. We've got some really nice fluffy white clouds in that direction against the blue sky, which always looks good in photos. And then in that direction, we've got these crazy stormy clouds, which just looks so dramatic. Yeah, which is great. So what we're going to do today is we're going to do a bit of moody black and white, and we're going to look at how, you know, when you haven't got that amazing sunset with, you know, the golden light and all that kind of stuff, you can use mono to really add kind of drama and interest to your images. So you're going to head over there, right?
Yep.
And I'm heading over there, so we'll see what we can get.
I'll see you in a bit.
All right. Okay, so I've got my camera set up on a tripod here on the beach, and as you can see, it's pointing down towards the ground at the moment because there's a few kind of spots of rain flying around, and I don't want those to go onto the filter, otherwise it'll be a nightmare to get off. So I'll leave my camera like that in that position until I want to shoot, and then I can raise it and take a shot and then drop it back down again so it doesn't get spots of rain on. Now, my first location is just here on the beach. There's a bit of a kind of a plateau of sand, and the tide's just gone out, and it's left these kind of little ripples, these crests and troughs of sand, and in the troughs there's still water, and that's reflecting off the sky and giving a really nice kind of contrasty textured pattern that leads the eye in towards the castle because it's aligned in this direction, and that's going to help to draw the viewer into the frame, just like we were talking about yesterday when we were in Scotland. Now, one little tip which I always do when I'm shooting black and white is to put my camera into monochrome mode, and that means that you'll be able to see what your black and white looks like on the screen as you shoot. So in other words, rather than shooting in color and then going home and converting your images to black and white and them not turning out quite as you imagine them, you'll be able to see exactly what you're getting right here, and that can be really, really helpful. But here's the thing. If you're working in JPEG and you use monochrome mode, then you won't have any color information recorded at all. So when you get back, if you do want to have your photo in color, you won't be able to because you haven't got the color information. However, if you're shooting in RAW, you will still see your image in black and white on the back of the screen. But when you get home, you'll find that your images are still in color. The color information is all still there because RAWs are always shot in color. So that's a really nice technique for seeing what you're getting right now without throwing away all that color information that you might decide that you want later. Thank you.
Now, the rules for shooting mono are a little bit different than shooting for colour. So if you're shooting in colour and you're shooting a magnificent sunset, then all of the clouds are going to be different shades, different colours. You're going to have some reds in there, some purples, some gold, and it's going to look really pretty. But if you're shooting in the middle of the day, then your clouds are all going to be of roughly the same colour. But that doesn't mean that they're all going to be the same tone. You're going to have darker bits, you're going to have lighter bits, and that's what shooting mono is all about, capturing that tone rather than the colour. So if you think of if you took a picture of, say, a red ball on green grass in colour, that looks really striking and you can really see the difference in the colour. But if you put that into black and white, then the two tones would look virtually identical. So when you're composing for a mono image, you want to be looking for things that really contrast in tone rather than in colour. So what I've got here is I've got this really dark seaweed that's coming through. It's really saturated with water, really dark in my frame. And then I've got the kind of the lighter bits of the water as well, all matched in there together. I've also got the sky, which has got some really nice contrast there as well. So this should make a really great dramatic mono image. So let's take a shot and see what it looks like.
Louise,
hey.
We've got 10 minutes left. We've got to go.
We've had
99 hours and 50 minutes of our challenge.
Yeah, and for the last 10 minutes, I want to get a shot. It's fine.
All right. So what are you working on?
Well, I wanted to get away from the rocks and the seaweed and try something a bit more simple and minimalist. So I've come right down to the shoreline. I've got the waves crashing in against my feet, making my legs and my socks and my feet very wet. But it's fine because we're going to go home a little bit.
Yeah.
But it's really nice. I think the best thing about this is that no matter where you are on a beach, you know that you've always got the sea, and that can always be your lead-in line.
That's absolutely like if there's nothing else available, if there's no rock formations or anything like that, you can always rely on that little shoreline where the wave breaks in, and you've got the dark sand because it's wet. And then the white of the breaker, and it just looks great in black and whites, doesn't it? It's brilliant.
No, it's so true. I've got a nice six-stop ND filter, which is giving me about a quarter of a second of exposure.
Nice.
Which means that it's not completely sharp, but it's not kind of totally blurred out either. It's just a nice medium between that.
That's a good tip. It's a good tip. Quarter of a second's a really nice exposure time for seas.
Yeah.
Because you get that just a bit of movement without losing the detail, which is great.
Yeah.
And then I think another good tip is that, you know, when you wear waterproof boots, it's best if you wear them in water that's lower than the height of the boot, otherwise
it goes
over.
You know what,
that
makes total sense.
Yeah.
I think next time I'm going to try that.
Right, we've got 3 minutes or something to get back to the car, so one more shot and then we're out of here.
Right, let's do it.
All right, we've got a wave coming in right now. Here we go.
Come on.
It's going to be a good one. Okay, ready?
Almost. Okay, let's do it.
Love nice. That. Look at
awesome.
That.
Awesome. All right, let's go to the car. Great.
Let's do it.
So we have come to the end of our epic photography road trip. I've really enjoyed it. Have you enjoyed it?
Immensely. What a week. I mean, five different locations, really different kinds of shot, loads of new techniques. Oh, loved it.
Yeah.
Doesn't get any better than that.
Definitely. I think the only gripe I would have is the weather, but you know what? When we were looking at the weather forecast last week, we were thinking, oh, God, this is going to be terrible. It's going to be raining every week. Is it even a good idea going? And honestly, I'm so glad that we did, because the vast majority of the time, the weather actually bucks up really well.
Yeah. If there's one thing you can say about the forecasters is that they're wrong virtually all the time. That's one thing we've learned this week. They just cannot get it right. And therefore, as a photographer, I would say, even if the forecast isn't looking good, get out there and just stick with it.
Yeah.
And I reckon there's a good chance that it will change and you'll get the shot that you want.
Yeah, I think it was only twice that we really thought that the weather wasn't going to work in our favour, and that was at Cornwall where we kind of stuck through with it, and then at the Lake District where we kind of postponed and got the shot later on. But other than that, I think it worked really well. So genuinely, you know, if the weather is looking a bit ropey, just go out there and do it anyway.
Yeah. Is there a place, I mean, we went to five locations and it was tough picking all five and getting them all on a route, and is there a place that you wish that we'd been able to include on that list?
I wish we'd been able to go to some part of Wales, because I think it would have been nice to kind of veer off there. But unfortunately,
maybe the Brecon Beacons or something.
Unfortunately, you know, it was adding on too much time to our journey, because I know that we did consider it, but we just had to kind of leave it, unfortunately.
Yeah, and for me, I think Dorset is the place that I would love to have included, because it's such a good location for landscapes. But
yeah, that Jurassic coast, just beautiful.
Yeah, you can't include everywhere there.
Oh, well.
Yeah, next time.
Yeah, 100th disc special. Yeah.
So that brings us to the end of our 50th ever edition of Learn Photography Now. We hope that you've enjoyed watching our discs as much as we've enjoyed making them. And we hope to see you next month, same time, same place, for the new edition of Learn Photography Now.
We'll see you then.
Goodbye.